and let's say total pressure. So the reason why we were discussing this was due to the Bernoulli equation. Bernoulli's equation, which is in fact, which is sort of a relationship between velocity and pressure. There are different terms in that equation, right? So each term is kind of lumped as pressure, right? Even the component which has velocity in it, we call it like a dynamic pressure, which is coming due to the fact that the fluid is moving. It translates into something known as a dynamic pressure, right? So if you look at all the terms, there's a static pressure term, there's a dynamic pressure term, and both of them together, it kind of gives you the stagnation part, and then there's a Z part, which was also there in chapter 2, right? Due to the height effect, right? The hydrostatic component part of it. So whenever you have all these things together, the total effect is the total pressure, right? And we assume that as we traverse the streamline, these things remain constant. They kind of interchange, but the total pressure within the fluid remains constant. So that's kind of the thing. But the most important part, which I want you guys to remember, is that there is assumption. There are assumptions associated with Bernoulli's equation, right? Right. You should remember what are those conditions, because whatever formula you are using, you should know what are the limitations. Right in the morning, there was like a PhD student doing research on his topic, and he said, "Oh, I'm doing a project in which there are frictional losses due to which this thing is not working, and I also proved it using mathematical formulation, and I used Bernoulli's equation." Right. So at one end, we are talking of frictional losses, which are due to the viscous effects, the boundary layers, bend in the pipe, all these things, they are there. And the mathematical model, which is being used to predict what will happen in the future, that is how the velocity would change, how the pressure would change, we have a Bernoulli's equation, right? So the, if you code that thing or do number crunching, you will get some answer, but that would not be a true picture, right? Excuse me. So my aim of teaching this class is like you should know these fundamentals. These are more important rather than doing number crunching, right? I give you three numbers and ask you the fourth one. You have A1, V1 equals A2, V2. And you also feel good while you are going back, oh, I got 100% in the quiz. Right? It's just not that. It's maybe a high school level thing. It's not the aim or objective. I want that somebody should develop a liking for this subject, and down the road, maybe in 10 years time or 20 years, they should pursue their career or apply this knowledge to some practical stuff. So far so good? Right? So that's the idea. Moving on, and I drew this picture. There was the flow coming this way, and then we had another thingy here. So there was some fluid rising up here, right? There was some rise in fluid here. There was a bigger rise somewhere here. So initially, once, let's say, it started to flow, after a while, this is being balanced by the atmospheric pressure, so it kind of stays, no more fluid can go in. So this becomes like a point where the fluid comes in and it comes to a halt. So all the velocity stuff is now transformed back into pressure. Right? That is what is happening. So this point is known as stagnation point. Stagnation point. And that amounts to both static plus dynamic thing, right? Over here, you just get a static pressure, which is as the fluid is moving, and you are moving with the fluid, and you have some gauge and kind of measuring how much pressure is there. So that's something which is static stagnation point. And then if there is, this is the stagnation streamline, which is coming straight. If there is no height involved, then this also gives the total pressure. But if there is a change in height, which is the effect of hydrostatic, that you have a water column on top of you, so that causes the third component, gamma z part. But let's say if there is a structure here, now I'm speaking a little loosely. Loosely means it's not the best kind of explanation. So there are some streamlines which are going above. There is one streamline going below it. So now the line which kind of demarcates these two regions is the stagnation streamline. Again, stagnation streamline. From dynamical systems point of view, this can also be referred to as separatrix. And these are different manifolds. Just listen and forget. Don't dare even to Google it. Right? You will have problems. You'll get lost. So don't do it. Right? There's some, but just for you, if somebody uses it, you are in some MSc thesis defense or some guys are talking about it. Oh, you heard this thing. Don't get shocked. Right? So just these words, buzzwords are there. But later on down the road, maybe few of you would pursue their masters. If the market doesn't come up, then maybe 80% would be doing their masters, right? So this is what it is. Next slide. And we said that there is what? We gave few examples. That part I think we did already. Anyways, there is a little figure in the book, so I don't miss it. This is the way a stagnation, let's say if the flow is coming this way, so you measure pressure here, static pressure. But let's say if there is a machinist who is kind of making this P dot static tube for an aircraft, and he does something like this. A good picture is given in the book. And the flow is coming like this. So what would happen is that the pressure over here, let's say pressure over here, or pressure over here, which is the static pressure, this pressure P1 would be less or more. What do you think? Less, more. Okay, let's see what is happening. Let me draw this as an exaggerated figure. Exaggerated means out of proportion. Let's see what is this. This one is a huge wall, and you have something like this. So the fluid is coming in, and it kind of, this one is kind of going this way, right? So this is sort of a wake, or a region where there is a kind of flow would go something like this. In reality, this is like a real flow. In reality, this would happen. So now this wake, where it kind of circulates, this causes more velocity. Like it goes, the flow goes a little faster as compared to the normal flow field. So as the velocity kind of, these are vortex, right? So these things, they cause suction. Less pressure is known as suction, right? So the moment there is a lesser pressure here, so we say that the pressure which is sensed is less than the actual pressure which should have been there. The suction phenomena, how many of you have seen? I think I asked, twister, right? Hurricanes, tornadoes. If you see a video or on a YouTube, you might see that if there's a huge, enormous kind of twister or tornado coming, so rather than crushing the house, it lifts the house, especially the rooftops. It just takes it away. Why? Because those high winds, they cause low pressure. And we do not have roofs here of this kind, but in other parts of the world, they have wooden rooftops. So there is a pressure within the house or under that roof, which is a P, and then the pressure on the top is like P1, which is much lesser than. So higher the winds, lower the pressure, so there is a suction created and it goes up. So that's kind of the phenomena. So whenever you are designing, let's say, if this is your house, nice little house, right? And if you decide to have like a car park here, give it a little angle so that if the wind comes like this, it kind of produces this force. Because if you give it a wrong angle, let's say if you try to give this kind of an angle, right? Although it may, you think it looks better, but it will give this kind of force and it might fly off. So intuitively you should know that negative pressure, suction, what does that do? Yes?
This velocity is more than the outlet.
Which velocity?
The
oh, so this is kind of, there is a balance of momentum. You have to balance momentum, which is mass times the velocity. So since there is kind of a lesser of the mass coming in here, MV, so the velocity kind of adjusts itself. So this is chapter 6. We'll do momentum equation and then we'll study why this is happening in a real flow, the one which we see, right? Okay, likewise, if you have this kind of stuff, so you are kind of holding the pressure, just like adding some sort of stagnation. So this now P1 would be greater than P, this is less than P. Illustration is given in the book, so that's something. And the same kind of phenomena that is also used for flow direction. Let's read the book, I would say. So, in let's say the example in the book is this one. This is a circular path, and you have you have these three ports. So, if the flow is exactly straight, so the pressure here and the pressure here is same, static pressures. The way they are measured, they are exactly same. But the moment the flow is in this direction, this will kind of vary. So you would kind of know that, okay, the pressure is different. But this is kind of the stuff which is a good read, I would say, just to get an idea what is happening. Okay, now a few examples. Red looks fine to everybody. Should I change it? Okay, some examples of Bernoulli equation. Free jets, right? So a free jet is let's say we have a huge tank. Oh, my bad. This height is H. Excuse me. And then there is this, let's say, dire D kind of thing, and the water kind of flows out, right? So now if I want to have the velocity measurement, so I can use Bernoulli's equation, which is what?
P1 greater than
Sorry, I just put it on vibrate and it still shouts. So we say that this is a huge water tank and the pressure is, let's say, atmosphere or kind of gauge thing, right? And this is also atmosphere, so that gauge pressure is zero. And we are interested in the kind of velocity which is right here, which is, let's say, V2. And since this is not flowing, it's just static, so this is zero. This is zero. This is what? This is H. P2, again, the particles, they touch the atmosphere, so this is zero. This is, we have to find. And Z2, there is no height. As of now, we say that there is no height. So what do we get? So what do we get? Like a gamma H is half rho V2 square, which is which is, yeah, 2GH. Have you ever seen this equation before? Where? Now, where did you see it before? First year physics? Yeah, you must have seen it somewhere. That guy, Torricelli or something, right? Some 17th century guy. So everybody is a pre-engineer here? Sure? Okay. Because the kind of look few people give once they see an equation, I thought that we have 50% pre-medical students sitting here. Right? Such a blank look. The moment you write an equation, what was that? So good, everybody is a pre-engineer, so they should know this stuff. And okay, let's add one more thing to it. It is falling like this, and let's say we want to measure this height, this is height H, and we want to measure the velocity here. And this is kind of H. Right? So now what do you think the velocity should be? So we have this. Why? Because it's just falling the same height. And the water column on top of it stays there. This is kind of a vertical jet, that is why it is happening. There's a vertical jet, that's why it is happening like this. Right? There is something known as, by the way, why would the velocity increase? Right, there is something happening here, which is G. And what is G? It's acceleration. So once there is acceleration in the same direction, the velocity has to increase. There is something known as a terminal velocity. Terminal velocity. Right, so after a while, let's say that concept is for, let's say the typical example is of paratrooper kind of guy. Right, he comes in, otherwise he keeps on accelerating and smashes and gets into thousands of pieces maybe. Right, but after a while, because of the drag is balanced by the upward force and the downward force, they are equal. So when the moment that happens, you do not get the increase in the velocity, right? Just as a side note. Okay, what is next? Next thing is, let's say we had a vertical jet, and let's say now we are going to discuss a case where we have this kind of stuff. Right? Now this is filled with water, and this comes like this. Right? Excuse me. Okay, now there, based on the shape of the outlet, in the book, they have some better pictures here. So, but let's see what can we do with this. Let's say if there is a smooth outlet, something like this. So it would, the streamlines would come like this, right? Something like this. This is what is happening. Okay? So the point here is, let's say you have a sharp edge. Something like this. Please consult the book, otherwise you would get lost based on my drawing. Okay. Now this is a very sharp edge. That means the streamlines, they have to turn how much degree?
99.
Right. In order to have exactly the same kind of outlet, they have to come and turn 90 degrees, something like this. And while we were discussing the streamlines in the normal direction, we had a V square over R thing. R was the radius of curvature, how the streamlines they are taking on a bend or something. So this sharp 90 degree turns means that the radius is effectively zero. And you are such a sharp corner that radius is zero. So the normal acceleration, which is V square over R, that goes to infinity. Can you have infinite acceleration? Zero acceleration, what does that mean? No, but in this case, in order to have, for a fluid particle to have a 90 degree turn, you need infinite acceleration. Right? Right. Can you have infinite acceleration? For a fluid particle, it is not possible. But maybe at the age of 20, you can have. You can accelerate your bike or car in like a fraction of seconds. You want to go like 60 miles per hour, starting from zero, right? So that is not possible. Don't even give it a shot, right? Don't just, while at 4 p.m., we should hear a crash because somebody was trying to make a infinite acceleration at this U-turn. Don't do it. So the point is, this is not possible. So the particles, they have to have a smoother turn. So I'll blow up this picture. I'll make a better view now, which is, let's say, make a bigger zoom in kind of thing. Let's make this, where you have, let's say this. So ideally what should happen is this. A particle should come in and take this turn right away and go here. But this is not possible. So what it would do, it would take a very nice smooth turn. Let's make it with some other color. It comes in and makes kind of this turn, and similarly it makes this kind of turn. So now if you look at this, this is let's say diameter of J, and this is diameter H, DH kind of thing. This is strange. Anyways, we'll draw here. Yeah. Good. So now think of this. Let's say if you desire as an engineer, you are designing some water jet kind of thing, and you want a specific amount of velocity coming out, or whatever is the design objective, and you design this sharp edge, and you think that, oh, the outlet is there, so you apply 2GH, all kind of formulas, and you do all sort of calculations to for the design, for the requirement. But in reality, what would happen is the fluid will not exactly take a 90 degree turn, and it would reduce the height of this jet. which is coming out. So this phenomena is known as, let me check the spelling, vena contracta. Maybe, I'm not sure the history of this, but the outlet is kind of constricted. There's a contraction in the outlet. So if it is a, let's say if it is a pipe, then we talk of areas, area A, right? So the corresponding area would be, let's say AJ, and this would be AH. If it is like a surface area you are considering. So you might think that you have designed something of a specific outlet area, but in reality, due to these sharp edges, the water will think that the outlet is like J, not H. So that is why while designing it, you have something known as contraction coefficient, which is, let's see, C is AJ over AH, which would be DJ DH square, based on the formula between going back and forth. Right. No, again, that's the point I was thinking. If it is the effective diameter, then what should happen to the velocity? Depending upon if the mass flow rate, if it has to conserve the mass flow rate, then the velocity would kind of increase. Otherwise, mass flow rate might be less. That's something which we might have, I need to think, I guess. I need to think what really happens. But the point is, whenever there is a different design of outlet, so you talk of this thing. Right? Maybe it is 60% coefficient or whatever the coefficient is. So you should know that whenever you are designing like an outlet, you should take care of this factor as well. And if you have, okay, it's given in the book, but let's draw it. If you have, extended the walls or the outlet as a complete pipe, then there is no kind of, it follows this path. There is a smooth curve here, smooth bend. So CC is like 1.0. And similarly, if it is exactly 90 degrees and you leave it right here, so in the book the value is like 0.61, 61%. And this is, by the way, this is this. And okay. I don't know, it's still on vibrate and it keeps on bothering me. Sorry. Okay. So this means that now the effective length would be smaller. And likewise, if you have kind of a weird shape, something like this. So the fluid comes in and takes this kind of turn, then the coefficient is 0.5. That's given in the book. So you can see the true shapes and kind of analyze what is happening. But the key point is that if you have sharp bends, then you do not get what theoretically you might be calculating. Oh, this is the diameter, this is the outflow. No. Right? Based on this coefficient, there would be some reduction. Okay, so we have next slide as confined Which means now everything is what? Let me use this word. Yeah, it is confined. You have walls everywhere. Now, I think this might give that answer that in this case, whatever is coming in, it has to go out. Now the Q, which is the mass flow rate, it should remain the same, right? Rho 1 A1 V1, rho 2 A2 V2. So that part holds true here in this case, right? So in this confined case, let's say we have this box and there is an incoming flow here and there's an outlet here. So within this, there is rho 1, V1, A1, rho 2, V2, A2. And by the way, chapter 5 is full of this. There is a control volume approach, and you would get fed up of the kind of examples that the book gives. So many examples. Control volume is fixed, it is moving, it is getting crazy, and all that stuff. Right? So control volume means whatever is coming in is going out. If the control volume is moving itself, so those are the things which are covered in detail. So this rho 1 A1 stuff is coming in chapter 5. Sorry? So most of the things in the initial chapters, they are warning you what is coming ahead. Right? Especially up till chapter 3. Chapter 4 is kind of mathematical, which would be interesting. It would be a killer, I would say. It would help me making like A, B, C, D grades. So I like that part. So again, in this case, we say that Q1 is equal to Q2. That's the point. And what we are saying is that we make assumptions again. This is the most important thing. We make assumptions of inviscid, incompressible, steady, blah, blah, blah stuff, and then apply Bernoulli's equation. And then we apply Bernoulli's equation. Okay? So, if the flow is incompressible, then what happens? So, this kind of drops out, and you are left with A1 V1 equals A2. V2. Okay, so this is what it is, and right. I had asked the next of kin of CR to remind me at 12:40. I'm waiting for how much time is left?
2 more minutes.
Okay. Good. That's good. I like it. So let me take a roll call right now because I might be running a little early. You can prepare for the quiz like you have 120 seconds. Right? Let me save the file and kind of and write the quiz.